sponsored by Brilliant. Our homes have an important role to play in meeting the 2030 carbon reduction targets that are set up by many countries. Alternatives like earthships, modular homes, and passive houses can really help reduce the carbon footprint of our houses, but they aren't affordable for most people yet. What if we could build houses that require much less energy to maintain, construct, heat, and cool? Let's explore tiny sustainable houses and how they stack up against traditional homes and sustainable alternatives. I'm Matt Ferrell. Welcome to Undecided. The path to decarbonizing requires major changes from most industries. Renewable energy and electric vehicles are only a few pieces of the decarbonization puzzle. We can have a big impact on climate change with the way we build our houses and the energy we use in them, but for most people, most likely all people, cost is a factor that has to be considered as well. In the US, the residential sector is responsible for about 20% of carbon emissions and accounts for 21% of all electricity consumption in the country. Here, space heating and cooling were estimated to account for about 42% of US homes' energy in 2021. In the UK, households also have a significant share of carbon emissions, accounting for 40%. And although the emissions declined from 12.8 tons in 1990 to 8.1 tons in 2014, there's still a lot to be reduced to try and hit the carbon targets over the next few decades. In order to reduce the carbon footprint of our homes, sustainable alternatives like passive houses, earthships, and modular homes have become pretty popular. They take into consideration things like orientation, insulation, use of greener or repurposed materials, in the case of modular homes, off-site construction. But the larger the size of the house, the more expensive and carbon-emitting it is. As a result, people have started to question if we really need big homes that demand more building materials and consume more electricity. And here in the US, we love our big homes. Since the 1950s, the average size of a new single-family home in the US has jumped from 950 square feet, which is actually about the size of my house, which was built in 1954, to over 2,000 square feet. In this context, the movement of tiny houses has been gaining momentum in the home building sector as a more sustainable and affordable approach. Tiny homes are typically no larger than 400 square feet, and in some cases, they can be as petite as 80 square feet total. That's about the size of the room I'm sitting in, so I'm not sure I could live in a house that small. But they have low maintenance and energy consumption and are more affordable than traditional homes. However, it's not just affordability. There's a whole movement and mindset behind the construction of these houses. You could say that small living goes back to the earliest humans, occupying caves, built structures like igloos, tents, and huts. But that was probably more out of necessity than anything else. Jump forward to 1854, when Henry David Thoreau's book Walden was published, detailing his experiences living for 2 years in the woods in a 150-square-foot cabin near Walden Pond outside Concord, Massachusetts. That's certainly a tiny house, and probably did inspire some people to try living a more simple, uncomplicated life. But the jumpstart of the tiny house movement is much more recent, with several books being published on the topic, including The Small House Book by Jay Schaefer in 1999. He kicked off the first company to sell tiny mobile homes in the US, the Tumbleweed Tiny House Company in California. I love that name. A few years later, Schaefer and other enthusiasts of the tiny home movement founded the Small House Society, aiming to pool their knowledge together and support more research and development on small living. Since the mortgage crisis in 2008, the prices of houses have been going up, especially during the pandemic, and the interest in downsizing and living in a more modest home has increased significantly. Although tiny homes do live up to their name from the size perspective, they use clever designs and hacks that create multi-purpose spaces for living rooms, kitchens, bedrooms, bathrooms, and essential storage. While they can be built on foundations, the concept behind tiny homes has freedom in mind. So they're commonly built on trailers or wheels, allowing owners to move to other places quickly and easily. This also avoids the need to spend money on permits or planning permissions needed with a fixed structure. It shouldn't be a surprise, but they could be powered by renewables like solar and wind in addition to regular grid-connected electricity. Adding panels will increase the upfront cost of tiny homes, and depending on the location where owners might want to move to next, the number of panels may not be enough to fully power a tiny home in an off-grid situation. You can get around that by also having batteries or a backup generator, which would also increase the costs. But for that reason, tiny houses are often just hooked up to the local grid, rather than being fully off-grid. People move to tiny houses for all sorts of reasons: financial, lifestyle, maintenance, portability, downsizing, and environmental concerns. It's a very flexible option that can fit a number of motivations. When choosing a tiny home, there are two main costs to consider: economic and environmental. In terms of economics, these homes are much more affordable than traditional homes, earthships, modular homes, or passive houses, allowing people to own their home without spending hundreds of thousands of dollars. And on the environmental front, these homes have a considerably lower carbon footprint because they're built with fewer materials, consume much less energy and water, and produce less waste. The average tiny house consumes only 7% of the electricity that it takes to power an average-sized house. Most tiny homes have a 30-amp power capacity compared to the 1 to 200 amps required by traditional homes that may have central heat and air conditioning. In fact, a tiny house produces about 2,000 pounds of CO2 emissions yearly, while an average-sized home releases about 28,000 pounds into the atmosphere. While average-sized homes have 20 to 40 light bulbs, a tiny house only needs 6 light bulbs on average. And some owners choose to go without appliances that may be considered essential for most of us, count me on that list, like TVs, microwaves, a washer and dryer, which helps with the energy efficiency. And you can also make them even more sustainable if they're built with recyclable materials, reclaimed products like corrugated tin, reclaimed barnwood siding and windows, reused pine flooring, or shipping pallets. And as a bonus, for those of you who don't like cleaning, count me in on that, living in a tiny house can be great since you'll have much less area to clean and probably fewer things to organize. Now, these houses can also increase a sense of community and social connections by sharing items that you or others don't have, like a washing machine, Wi-Fi, or even just spending time outside with other people. Spending time with other people. I remember what that was like. The cost of tiny homes are just a fraction of the price of conventional homes. Obviously, the price will vary according to size, interior design, whether it's mobile or not, and the type of materials that are used to build it. The basic cabin kit can cost as low as $6,000 to $8,000, while nicely designed tiny houses can be as much as $100,000 or more. But the average cost of a tiny home is about $45,000 here in the US. On the flip side, Zillow estimated the average American home as of November 2021 was about $300,000. In order to compare the cost of a traditional home with a tiny house, let's consider an owner with excellent financial credit. Take a traditional mortgage of about $250,000 with an interest rate of 4% and a term of 30 years. The monthly payment would be about $1,193. And for the total interest paid over the life of the loan, we're looking at about $179,673. So the final cost of this house is going to be about $429,673. Financing a tiny home can be tricky, since there are minimum loan amounts and some lenders require that homes have a permanent foundation. But you could get a personal loan, or in the case of mobile tiny homes, potentially get RV or trailer financing. Using that for our example, a $60,000 tiny house loan with an interest rate of 6% and a maximum term of 15 years means the monthly payment would be about $506, and the total interest paid would be about $31,135. The total cost of your tiny portable house would be about $91,135, considerably lower than the traditional house. Now, the biggest savings most tiny house owners have comes from the fact that they don't have a monthly mortgage payment. 68% of tiny house owners have no home payments at all, compared to 29.3% of all American homeowners. In addition, 55% of those who convert to the tiny house movement have more savings than the average American, and 65% have no credit card debt. Most who live in tiny homes spend about $10 to $35 a month on all of their utilities, while an average-sized house usually has a monthly bill of about $240. My utility bill says hello. And when you look at other types of sustainable homes, tiny houses are more affordable. While they have an average cost of about $150 per square foot, Earthships cost between $150 and $225 per square foot, and passive homes cost $166 to $231 per square foot, as I've covered in previous videos. However, other costs need to be considered when building a tiny house, like building permits, which generally cost around $1,350 on average here in the US, a foundation which costs about $4 to $7 per square foot, and a piece of land if you're targeting a permanent home, and the land value will vary a lot depending on location. With the spread of this tiny movement, several companies have been building tiny homes around the globe, and the options range from cheap and simple cabins up to luxury homes, albeit they're tiny luxury homes. The Canadian company Minimalist, for example, builds tiny houses on wheels that can feature solar-powered electric systems, propane systems, integrated drinking water, or gray water tanks that can allow for off-grid life for all types of climate. The prices range from about $85,000 to $160,000 Canadian, which is about $67,000 to $125,000 US. And depending on the model, it can accommodate from 2 to 8 people. 8 people living in a tiny house? That sounds like a reality TV show. On the other end of the spectrum, there are also very cheap options, like the Bala Bunky cabin built by the US company Summerwood. This cabin design has 230 square feet of usable space, but the clever design only has a footprint of about 100 square feet, and it comes with an increased roof pitch to create plenty of loft space. The kit price costs about $10,000, and in most jurisdictions, it doesn't require a permit. But the cost of the bunkie doesn't include any insulation or the addition of plumbing or electrical. You're literally just buying a box. But if you can get by without that, living the Walden way, this could be a bargain. In the UK, Tiny Eco Homes builds towable eco-mobile homes in three ranges: traditional, elegance, and elegance grand. The prices range from £42,000 to £62,000, with sizes from 144 to 224 square feet. Their tiny houses are more on the luxury end of the spectrum for people who want to downsize without giving up the comfort. Their traditional range of tiny homes feature double-glazed windows and doors, thermally treated exterior cladding, LED lighting and electrical throughout, several appliances, and the bathroom includes a luxury steam spa shower cubicle. That sounds nicer than my house. Not only has this tiny house movement been getting traction around the world, it's getting traction online. You can buy a tiny home on Amazon. I wonder if they'll deliver it next day. But you may not want to make that purchase sight unseen. And if you're interested in tiny home living but aren't sure it's right for you, you could simply rent one and test it out. In the US, there are more than 7,000 tiny homes available to rent on Airbnb. For example, you can rent this one-bedroom tiny retreat near Ski Round Top in Wellsville, Pennsylvania, for $161 a night. You can try out several options this way before making your decision to go all in on small living. And even though the tiny house movement has been gaining popularity, there are still some issues to be considered. In the US, there are many different laws regarding zoning regulations of tiny homes, varying state to city to town. In most areas, these homes need to have a minimum ceiling height of at least 6 feet 4 inches in bathrooms and 6 feet 8 inches in common areas to ensure safety. In addition, they need to have at least one separate bathroom, an emergency exit, a staircase or a ladder that leads to any lofted spaces, but those requirements vary depending on where you're building or parking your tiny home. The 10 most popular states in the US for tiny homes are Utah, New York, North Carolina, Arizona, Washington, Oregon, Texas, Colorado, Florida, and California. Tiny homes have become an interesting asset in the building sector that can help drag carbon emissions down or just save you a lot of money in how you live. The tiny home market is set to grow by about $3.33 billion at a rate of about 4% through 2025. With the increased interest in tiny living, no matter what your underlying motivations are, builders are popping up around the globe to fill that need. Now, I don't know if I could live in one, it's too small for my family, but it could be a great option for you. And when it comes to figuring out your options and what's right for you, you've got to put logic to work. If you want to strengthen those logic muscles, I'd strongly recommend checking out Brilliant. I've been using Brilliant for quite a while now to help wrap my head around the fundamentals of the topics that I talk about, including using logic and critical thinking to break things down. They have hands-on interactive courses and topics that range from electricity and magnetism to solar energy and science essentials to gravitational physics. They've got something for everybody. The logic course is great for helping to build those critical thinking skills to make predictions from limited information. All of the concepts are taught through fun interactive challenges to help you understand the why of something, not just the how. It helps to develop your intuition, which is my favorite part about Brilliant. Go to brilliant.org/undecided to sign up for free. And also the first 200 people will get 20% off their annual premium membership. Thanks to Brilliant and to all of you for supporting the channel. But what do you think about tiny houses? Would you want to live in a tiny house, or do you live in one already? Jump in the comments and let me know. And thanks as always to my patrons, their direct support really does help produce these videos. And speaking of which, if you like this video, be sure to check out one of the ones I've linked to right here, and subscribe and hit that notification bell if you think I've earned it. Thanks so much for watching. I'll see you in the next one.